Good morning. In this sunny Tuesday, we're going to continue our 8-minute student presentation. And in this session, we are going to have 11 students who will talk about their selected topics. And the list of students is already given in EduNext, and I'm now planning to randomly call the presenter for today. And okay, let me see the participants list at the moment. So okay, we already have 14 students available in the classroom. So without further ado, we're going to start our first speaker. I would like to invite, okay, do we have Felix Cahyadi in the classroom? Okay, do we have Melissa Damayanti in the classroom?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay.
Please prepare your slide, and then after you able to prepare it, then you could start whenever you're ready.
Okay. Would you see my slide, sir?
Yes.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I would like to thank Mr. Ari for the opportunity. So let me introduce myself. My name is Melissa Damayanti, and I'm going to share my paper progress, but I'm still working with my paper. The title of my paper is The Influence of Montage Reverences on the Analysis of EEG Measurements. Okay, first we talk about the brain. So the human brain is one of the most complex system on earth. In the brain, there is an electrical activity, which if there is a disturbance in the transmission, it will be related to the malfunctions, and it can lead to a certain neurological disease. But are we just talking about the brain disease? Actually not, but we can analyzing such as our cognitive behavior while we try to make decision making, or while we are in anger, emotion, and many more. So the brain phenomena is very, very interesting. Okay, and we can get more insights from our brain. Okay, oh wait. So actually in the brain, we work with electrical systems. It is about moving ions from one side to another side, and cells have a membrane layer that contains with sodium and then potassium and chlorine ions and proteins also. When a given stimulus reach the threshold value, so there will be a depolarization process. Okay. So we talk about EEG. Electroencephalography is one of the most popular techniques in the study of brain dynamics. Human scalp electroencephalography has been used for brain study due to its sensitivity, non-invasive, and high time resolution. And successful about utilizing EEG usually depends on signal processing methods, including time resolution, and then analysis in references influence. So much evidence showing that the reference EEG is affect the measurements. So we need to investigate more about the influence of reference EEG simultaneously. Okay, we're going to talk about a bit the theory that built this research. So we will get to know the device that was first used by Hansperger in 19 and 24, which was later developed to this day, and is widely used in neuroscience research. And there are several standard placements of electrodes in the scalps, but the most common is the 10-20 placement, which determine based on the position of the electrodes against the lobes of the brain, labeled on the right as even numbers and the right as and the right as the odd numbers. So in EEG measurements, the value that we can get in real time is the value that the potential change over time at a measurement point. In practice, we have several references to potential measurements pattern that are commonly used, namely bipolar and referential montage. Okay. So referential montage, also known as a common reference montage, use a single electrode for input for all channels. And there are several types of referential montage, such as ipsilateral, contralateral, and then average. And the picture that I have attached here is the ipsilateral because the point of reference is follow the hemisphere position. So the left ear for the left hemisphere and the right ear for the right hemisphere. And each channel represents the potential difference between certain location of electrode and the common single electrode as reference. Some paper mentioned that the advantage of referential montage are preservation of the shape and the amplitude of the waveforms. While the bipolar montage has two types of arrangement, longitudinal bipolar montage and transversal bipolar montage. So bipolar montage electrode point connected to the neighbor reference point each other. So if the referential montage only need one or two points, the bipolar montage more than 2 points reference. And the picture that I have attached here is the longitudinal bipolar montage because the points of reference has one hemisphere with the electrode that we want to evaluate. And bipolar montage are useful for analyzing high localized discharge, and the artifact generally lower than the referential montage one. Okay, Nunas and Srinivasan mentioned that actually there is no monopolar recording on EEG, all recordings are bipolar. So this means that it is impossible to measure the potential at any given point without a reference. At least we need an infinitely spaced reference. So here is the potential equation, the simple potential equation that we use in EEG measurements, where I is denotes as the index of active electrodes and R is the reference that we use on the scheme. Depends on the scheme that we use, such as average, ipsilateral earlobes, and bipolar earlobes. Okay, after that, we talk about the method. So actually, the first we do the literature study, and then we do the data acquisition using EEG 19 plus two channels. We use 12 subjects, and they have to sleep and listening to acoustic rhythm. And then we do the data pre-processing, include filtering and then centering. And after that, we do the data processing, interrelation measurement, and brain plot and brain potential value plots. After that, we analysis of the interpreted results, and we hope we get a conclusion that which is the reference montage that suits for our research. Okay, so that's all from me. Thank you for your attention, and Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And okay, thank you, Melissa. Now we are moving on to the second speaker of the day. I'm going to invite Mulia Sijiastuti.
Oh yes, sir. Could you see my screen?
Yes, the slides is showing perfectly. And before we start with the presentation, I would like to remind the audience who are not presenting today to still evaluating the performance of today's presenter. And after we done with the whole presentation session on next week, you are required to submit not only your PPT or PDF of your presentation, but also the evaluation or the assessment sheet that you gave to each presenter. Okay, Moya, the time is yours.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Good morning, everyone. My name is Mulia Sujesti Wahyono. I'm from Physics of Magnetism and Photonics Research Divisions, Institute of Technology Bandung. Now, I want to show you about the characteristic optical response of nanoparticle aggregates. Okay, the Brigham and the research. Okay, in the end of this decade, nanoparticle technology to manipulate light has become one of the topics that always is developing in science and technology. And it can be used in the chemical sensing, biosensing, waveguides, fiber optics, and metamaterials. In nanosystem, there are many challenges, such as the manufacturing process and the selection of the right materials. And when the scattering objects irradiated by electromagnetic wave, it can be formed field wave, dipole radiation, or a laser beam. The wave will be scattered outward and absorbed into the object. And so the scattered electromagnetic wave, which consists of the electric and magnetic scattering field, it can be obtained analytically by metallurgy for scatterers with the spherical geometry. However, the scattering with arbitrary geometry, we must require scattering multiple electromagnetic computational methods. So in this research, we use the surface integral equation method. What is the surface integral equation? Surface integral equation is derived from Maxwell equation through Green's theory of functions. And the method is a good computational result for any solid scattering structure with range of permittivity. And so we can analyze the aggregate spectrum with a surface integral equation method. Okay, the theory. Okay, we start by reviewing the Maxwell equation in the matter. From the Maxwell equation on free charged particle, yeah, there's the equation, Maxwell equation, where D is the displacement field, E electric field, B is a magnetic field, and H is auxiliary field. And in this research, we will consider the scattering process where there is the geometry of the electric magnetic scattering problem. And then the region one is the background, where the background is bounded by the surface in the inside and bounded by S infinite at the outside. And then the region two is the scattering object, where the N1 and N2 is the normal unit vector, but in N1 is the normal factor for backgrounds, and N2 is normal factor for scattering objects. And then in this research, we use the electric field integral equation and magnetic field integral equation. And this is obtained, which is the sums of the incident field and scattering field. It is as given in the following equation. Equation one is for electric field, and the equation two is for magnetic field. To the equation of the electric field and magnetic field can be solved if the equivalent surface densities are known. So we must use the method of moments. This may be right as the metric equation AV equal B, where the A is the PMCWT matrix combines EV and MV matrix over domain, but putting the EV on the top half of the matrix and the MVE in the bottom of half. And the B matrix is the basis function multiplied by their field, where the field is the electric field and magnetic field. But to find out the element of the matrix D and K in the matrix A, we must know by the Dyadic-Green tensor, where the Dyadic-Green tensor is the homogeneous medium can be derived from the Green scalar function in the equation 6. And so we can now the D and K matrix element and can be raised as in the equation 7 and 8. Okay, there's the method of this research. Okay, we will start. And then we calculate the scattering electric and magnetic fields on the aggregate structure using the surface integral equation method. So we can find the scattering field, and then the scattering field we decomposition by multiple expansion methods, and then we get the coefficient of the scattering, and the coefficient scattering will be find the scattering coefficient and the multiple moment, and so we can calculate the percentage contribution of scattering field decomposition, and we can compare and analyze of the scattering response of aggregate structure with various types. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mulia, for talking about the computational method on materials. Okay, I'm gonna hesitating on commenting the presentation because we have a limitation in terms of time. So I will address the feedback to all of the presenters later on after we're done with the whole presentation session. And let us thank and give applause for Mulia for her presentation, so that now we can move on to the third presenter. I would like to invite Felix Cahyadi.
Okay. Can you already see my screen, sir?
Yes. Yes, you may begin.
Okay. Okay, so hello, good morning everyone, and good to see you. My name is Felix Cahyadi, and today I will present you a very interesting research topic. It is realization of quantum switch with single photon state control via polarization. And the title of the presentation will make sense to you later by the end of this presentation. Okay, so let us head to the first section. And in this introduction section, I'm going to discuss the general motivation of this research, why this research is important, and also I'm going to introduce to you the basics of quantum communication. Okay, so the general motivation. If you are following the technological advancement in the recent years, you should have heard of the development of quantum computers. And basically, it is a computer that handles quantum information instead of classical information. And it is a totally different technology from what you have with your PC, laptops, or mobile phones, for example. And what does a quantum computer do? They compute things and also communicate. And because it is done by a quantum computer, then we call it quantum computation. Basically, what we are trying to do here is to transmit information in form of quantum state that you can see in figure two. The quantum state here is the smallest information unit that you can have. And we will refer to it as a qubit, which means quantum bit. And the bit here means that it has two states, zero and one. And if you want to modify the quantum state, then you have to modify the value of alpha and beta here. Okay. And because the world, you know, basically the world obeys laws of quantum mechanics, that means we can actually realize the qubit in any physical system that has two-level quantum states. And here you can see some of the examples of it. We have, for example, superconducting qubit, trapped ion qubit, and lastly, photonic qubit. And in this presentation, we'll focus on the photonic qubit, and you will see the reason why later by the end of this presentation. And next, we are going to discuss the theory of this research. We are going to talk about the basics of communication and also quantum switch, which is a phenomenon that arises from quantum mechanics. So to the communication basics. In communication, we have three main components. We have the sender of the message, we have the receiver of the message, and we also have the channel. And channel is, you know, a medium in which you are sending your message through it. And also in the channel, anything can actually happen with the information that you are sending. You can modify the information using the channel, or you can also have maybe some noise that will destroy your information. And one of the interesting example of the setup for quantum channel is the quantum switch. And in this case, we have the control qubit that will control the quantum switch. And we also have rho t. This is the information that we want to send. And we also have the channel NP and NQ that the information will go through. And how it works is that if the value of the control qubit is zero, then it will go, the information will go through P and then go through Q first. Yeah, and then later it will get into the detector. And if the value is one, then it will be modified by Q first and then modified by P, and then it gets into the detector. And the interesting thing is that it doesn't have to be either zero or one. It can be in a superposition between both of them. And in this case, in case of superposition, in half of the case, it will go through P first and then Q. And in the other half of the cases, it will go through Q first before going through P. And it is interesting because we won't know the order of the channels. And this is the phenomenon that we want to realize. And the reason why we want this phenomenon, we want to realize this phenomenon is because we can use it to transmit information more effectively. Imagine if you have a totally noisy channel. If you have a totally noisy channel, if you send information through it, it will destroy the information. And then that means you cannot transmit any information. But if you set up two noisy channels in a superposition like this, you can actually send some information, because this behavior actually retains some of the information. And because of that, we want to actually realize this in a physical system. And I will explain to you why we choose photonic state to realize it, and also how the experiment will actually look like. So we'll move on to the photonic state. As you can see here on the table, a photonic state have several quantum properties that we can use to encode information, for example, polarization, orbital angular momentum, number of photons, and the time. And in this case, in this experiment, we will use spatial mode of the photon. Basically, the shapes that you see here, you can actually see them when you detect the photon using a detector. And you can modify the shape by getting them through a set of lenses. And because these states are that independent of each other, we can combine them in a single photon. So a single photon can have the shape and also the polarization. And now we'll move on to the experiment setup. In this setup, we have two polarizing beam splitter here and here. And we'll also have the channel A and B. And the channel is actually a set of lenses. So that means if the photon goes through A or B, they will get modified. And
I'm sorry to interrupt. You have 1 minute to close your presentation.
Okay. Okay, sir. And so we also have C, which will act as the detector. And we have the laser that is set up in the diagonal polarization. So that means in some cases it will go through A and then B and through the detector. And you can see that we can actually realize quantum switch in a physical system. And the result of the measurement can be used to calculate the amount of information that you can transmit through quantum switch. And this is why, yeah, so basically what we are doing here is to realize quantum switch using polarization to control the spatial state of the photon. And that's basically all I want to talk about in this presentation. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Felix. Okay, now we are moving on to the fourth presenter. I would like to call Anggun Yusifa.
Yes, sir. Can you see my share screen?
Yes.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, Mr. Hari and everyone. My name is Anggun Yusifa, and today I will tell you about my research topic about the effect of variation exposure factors on computed tomography dose index, or CTDI, in air. So, in the beginning, the use of medical device in the medical world is very important. One of the examination with medical equipment that use a radiation source is a CT scan. CT scan or computed tomography scan is a tool used to diagnose disease of organ in human body. However, during the scanning process, the patient will receive radiation from the CT scan field. the area or body part of exposure to radiation from any angle can cause a very large dose distribution. This large dose of radiation needs more attention so that it does not have negative impact on patient. Therefore, it is necessary to measure the amount of radiation dose received by the patient in each examination. Compared tomography dose index, or CTDI, is a method for calculating the amount of radiation to determine the output dose on a CT scan. The CTDI measurement consists of two measurements as a CTDI measurement in phantom and CTDI measurement in the air. And my research focus on CTDI in the air. The value of radiation dose in the air can be used to estimate the value of radiation dose received on the phantom. So the parameter that can affect of radiation dose received by the patient are exposure factor, include the voltage, the current time, and rotation time, pitch, and scan length. So this study aims to determine the effect of the voltage, time current, and pitch on the CTDI air value. CT scan has a relatively higher dose than other radiology tools. The main component of a CT scan machine are the patient couch, gantry, and operator console. The first is a patient couch. Patient couch is where the patient position for the scanning. This couch can be moved forward, backward, up and down. And the second is a gantry. Gantry is a component of a CT scan in which there are X-ray tubes, filter, detector, and data acquisition system, or DAS. The X-ray tube and detector are always opposite each other in the gantry and will rotate around the object to be scanned. The third is a computer or operator console. The function of operator console are to perform the process of scanning, reconstructing or processing data, display image, and analyzing image. Now let's move on how does a CT scan works. First, the X-ray emit from the tube are attenuation when passing the object and then captured by a detector. The detector located is behind the object. The radiation beam will be converted into electrical signal and will be converted into digital by an analog digital converter. And then data is sent to the computer and through a mathematical process. The data will be reconstructed and the image can be displayed on monitor screen. The index used to describe the dose output of a CT scan is called Compared Tomography Dose Index, or CTDI. CTDI is an integral part of radiation dose profile of a single axial scan normalized to the X-ray beam width. It estimates the average dose from a multi-scan examination, and CTDI 100 represents the accumulative dose of multiple scan in the middle of the scan length of 100 millimeter scan. The CTDI 100 has a range of minus 50 millimeters to plus 50 millimeters. And pitch is the ratio of the amount of table movement for one rotation to the collimation width. Where from this equation, D of Z is a dose profile along the Z axis perpendicular to the scan plane and is a number of tomographic slides produced in one rotation of X-ray tubes, and T is weight of the tomographic scan along the Z axis image, and I is the amount of table movement for one rotation. Next, move on the tools that I can use in my research. There are four tools that I use in this research. First, a multi-slice CT scan, 64 Siemens somatum sensation. The radiation dose received in multi-slice CT scan is higher than single-slice CT scan. The second one is the CT dose profiler, and the third is multimeter Barracuda and CT dose profiler analyzer software. And parameter variation for CT scan that I will be apply are tube voltage from 80, 100, 120, and 140. And tube current time from 100 until 350 mES. And then pitch from 0.75 until 1.5. And collimation width 5 millimeters, and other parameter keep constant. So the overall flowchart will be like this. Start and set up the CT DOS profiler and connect to the Barracuda multimeter and connect to computer to display the measurement result. And the CT DOS profiler is placed in the center of the gantry. So the sensor is free in the air and is arranged in the center of the horizontal and vertical laser marker. And then attach tape to the CT DOS profiler so its position does not change during measurement. And after positioning, then do the topogram on all parts of the CT DOS profiler to determine where the measurement starts and ends. Then set the parameter of the exposure factor and pitch with each variation of the voltage, the current time, and pitch. And do the scanning process. Once we are done with the scanning process, we get the result, and the last part is to analyze and finish. Okay, so this brings me to end of my presentation. Thank you for your attention, and good morning.
Okay, good morning. Thank you, Anggun. The next presenter, I would like to invite Muhri Izzat.
Can you see my slide, sir?
Yes, perfectly.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Muhri Izzat. I'm from Physics Department, Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Science, Institute Teknologi Bandung. Today, I will present about my topic with title Fire Point Detection System Using K-Nearest Neighbor Method. Public building fires are one of the hazards in the urban environment. In contrast to house fires, which are mostly caused by accident in the kitchen environments, many urban building fires are caused by electrical problem in installation or in electronic device. This kind of fires start at relatively small level, but can be dangerous to even large buildings. One of the security aspects in modern building today is the handling of fire hazard. The security system used today are generally based on smoke detection and alarm, where the way it works is by sounding warning and prevention by sprinkling water through sprinkler. However, the system has the disadvantage that it doesn't indicate the location of the fire, making it difficult to extinguish the fire. So I want to create a system that can cover these shortcomings. In this paper, the system developed detect the presence of fire determines the direction of the location of the fire in the room since the fire is still small. The system is made by considering two parameters, the fire parameters and the temperature parameters. The temperature parameters detected by the LM35 sensor, which work by changing the ambient temperature of the room into an electrical quantity in the form of a voltage. And the fire parameter, which is detected by a flame sensor, which work by receiving light wave generated by the candle flame. The calculation process is carried out when this sensor detects the sensor of the candle flame. The value detected by the LM35 sensor will be processed for the classification process. For the classification process in the system is using K-nearest neighbor. K-nearest neighbor method is a method for classifying object based on the learning data that is closest to the object. The way this method works is to find the number of nearest neighbor where the data that is closest and most appears will be used as the final result of the classification process. This method has several advantages over other methods. Namely, If it has a lot of training data, the results obtained are better. The block diagram shows the process of running a Fireopen location detection system with the Keras Navier algorithm. In this system, the room temperature value will be read by the LN35 sensor, and the flame sensor is used as trigger to start the KNN classification. In this calculation, there are four input values for the LN35 temperature sensor, where these values are obtained from each sensor, which is placed in each area according to the design. The number of sensors depends on the number of regions, where in this system, there are four regions. In the use of K-nearest neighbor, you must determine the value of K first, and the value of K will be used as the basis for applying the neighboring value when you finish classifying. For the system output, namely the classification result will be shown on the LCD layer, and there is a buzzer warning sound. In making a fire location detection system, a prototype is needed that is specifically designed to simulate an indoor fire, and it is very important to pay attention to the location of each component because it greatly affects the classification result later. The design of prototype is shown in Figure 4. In this system, using four temperature sensors and placed in each corner. In Figure 5 is an initial design in making a location of hotspot in the system. In the design, each point has a length and width of 2 cm each. This design also shows the regional division. Namely, the letter A is area 1, letter B is area 2, letter C is area 3, letter D is area 4, and each area has 9 points. In figure 6 and figure 7 shows the flowchart of how the system works. For the figure 6, it shows the flowchart system classification that starts from input the sensor data. The sensor data obtained from LN35. The process is carried out continuously until the flame sensor detects a flame. Then the LN35 sensor data will be stored and will be processed by the KNN. After the input from sensor data, the system will be reading training data before KNN classification. In the system flowchart, there is a KNN subprocess in which there is a procedure for the classification process to run correctly, which will be explained in accordance with Figure 7. KNN process start from input training data and K value test data. After that will be Euclidean distance process, and then taking K data based on the result of data distance, and the last, the result of the data test on the data training obtained. After the result of the KNN process are obtained, then determine the highest chance result, and the last, the result of the classification will be displayed on LCD layer. Okay, I think that's all from me. Thank you for your attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, thank you, Mufri. Okay, let me write the comments on the presentation. Okay, let me look at the participant list. Okay, for the next or the sixth presenter of today's session, I would like to invite Adrio.
Okay. Do you can see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My name, let me reintroduce myself. My name is Adrio Rifan. I am a member of the Physics of Magnetism and Photonics Research Group of Physics Department, Bandung Institute of Technology. Today I want to present to you about application of gallium phosphide as photovoltaic cell. Okay, this is the outline of this presentation. We start with the introduction and then basic theory that builds the this research and the methods that used in this research. Okay, we start with electricity. We must know what electricity is, and we also use it in our daily life. But and then we also knew that electricity need the fuel to produce it, or fossil fuel that is not the renewable energy and will run out eventually. And so the people try to generate the electricity through other method or through alternative and renewable energy, and the solar energy is one of them. And the photovoltaic is one of the method to generate electricity from the light. And then how we generate the electricity from light, we need some material to make the solar cell, and the 3-5 base alloy heterostructure have many great device application, and one of them is gallium phosphide that have an interesting feature for a high band gap solar cell. And but beside of solar cell, gallium phosphate itself have many applications such as LED and photocell. And for the solar cell itself, the third generation thin solar cells is the most promising solar cell in the photovoltaic region that is expected to achieve 35% of efficiency with the use of multi-junction cell. And what gallium phosphate used in the solar cell, in the photovoltaic cell, gallium phosphate can be used as the coating of the solar cell or the solar cell material itself. So yeah, gallium phosphate have many applications in one application itself, if I can say. And this research aim is to get the best fit parameter for the photovoltaic junction based on gallium phosphate. And the figure one is the show you the structure of the photovoltaic cell that is used in this research. Okay, we continue the basic theory of this research. The photovoltaic or PV or can be called PV cell is the device that convert solar energy into the electricity through the effect called photovoltaic effect. And the PV cell is compromised by some layer that is semiconductor layer of conducting materials, and anti-reflection coating. And the figure two show you the common structure of photovoltaic cell. And in the figure, there is a specially created semiconductor material that is semiconductor layer that I mentioned earlier, is the layer that will generate the electricity through the photovoltaic effect or the core of the structure itself. And the next one is layer of conducting material. In this figure is called as a front contact and back contact, is the layer that will collect the electricity generated from the semiconductor layer. And the last one is anti-reflective coating, is the coating that will that used to reduce the solar radiation that will reflect it back on the surface of the cell. And if we want to talk about photovoltaic cell, we must know the core of this cell, or that is photovoltaic effect. From what I mentioned earlier already, the PV cell is have a semiconductor layer in its structure, and this semiconductor layer is built from the p-type and n-type semiconductor that join together into the one that called PN junction. And in the PN junction, there will be an electric field generated that will allow the electron to move to the positive P type and the hole to move to the negative N type. And when the photon incident to the photovoltaic cell, The photon will give the energy into the electron and will make the electron excited into the higher energy state called conduction band. And in the conduction band, the electron can move freely, and this motion of electron that will generate the electricity. Okay, so we already talk about the photovoltaic and photovoltaic cell, and then how do we search the best fit parameter in this research. The method is divided into two steps. The one is characterization, and the next one is the simulation. And for the like response characterization, we use the Shannon-Lam AM 1.5 filter. And what we characterize is AQE, or internal quantum efficiency, and the spectrum power of the light. And then the simulation will be done with the device called ADAPT-F, or the drift diffusion based on solar cell simulator. Okay, that is the end of my presentation. Thank you for all your attention. Good morning.
Okay, thank you, Andrea. The following speaker would like to invite I would like to invite Siti Zahrato Janna as our seventh speaker.
Yes, sir. Okay, hello. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Siti Zahrato Janna. And today I would like to talk about my scientific research topic, that is green synthesis, zinc oxide nanoparticle using aqueous of extract of cucumber. And nanotechnology is a multidisciplinary technology that talks about the manipulation of particles at the nanometer scale. This technology offers a means of life. The supplies there is at the nanometer scale are 1 per 1 billion meters, which is known to produce new properties and behavior. Properties such as conductivity, reactivity, melting temperature, magnetic and mechanical properties will change when the particle are below 100 nanometer or become a nanoparticle materials. Nanomaterials have adjustable physicochemical properties such as size, morphology, surface charge, and stability. These properties have made nanomaterials very attractive in pharmacy and medical sector, even in cosmetic sector. Advances in the use of nanoparticle for application in the cosmetic sector by considering environment aspect encourage many researchers to synthesis nanoparticle using a green synthesis method. Various studies have shown that plants are considered to be prime candidates and suitable for large-scale green synthesis of nanoparticle, where the rate of synthesis in plants tends to have a greater value than other organisms. In addition, nanoparticle products from plants are more diverse in shape and size. The extract from plants are also considered to contain various phytochemicals such as flavonoid, phenolic acid, amino acid, and terpenoid, which is an important role in the process of synthesis nanoparticle. And in this research, I choose cucumber. And cucumber is a plant originating from northern India, namely the slope of Himalaya. In the photochemical test, cucumber has various active compounds such as mentioned before, like strenoid, terpenoid, alkanoid, phenolic, flavonoid, and saponin. In addition, cucumber can also be used in source of antioxidant because they contain vitamin C, vitamin E, provitamin A, organosulfur, flavonoid, thymoquinone, statin, niacin, picocyanin, and others. And eating cucumber can maintain a healthy body and skin. In addition, cucumber also can be used for medicine, like to lower blood pressure, maintain bone health, anti-cancer, and prevent dehydration. Zinc oxide is a type of metal nanoparticle. Zinc oxide nanoparticles have attractive properties such as wide band gap, high binding energy, and high piezoelectric properties. Zinc oxide nanoparticles can exhibit various nanostructures which are believed to be safe, non-toxic, biosafe, and biocompatible. Chemically, zinc oxide is rich in hydroxyl group, which allows zinc oxide to dissolve well in acidic and basic condition. And the method that I use in this topic research is green synthesis method, which is consists of extraction process, synthesis process, and characterization. The first step is extraction process. The first step is wash cucumber in running water to clean it from dust and dirt particle, and then slice cucumber into thin thickness. And after that, the thin cucumber arranged on an aluminum tray, then put it in the oven for 1 hour and set the oven at 60 degrees Celsius. After that, must dry cucumber, and then cucumber is filtered to obtain cucumber powder. After get cucumber powder, take cucumber powder extract about 2 grams for 100 milliliters of DI water. After that, heat it in water bath for 1 hour at 60 degrees Celsius. And then let's stand the extract at room temperature for 2 hours. After the extract have get room temperature, filter the extract using Wetman filter paper with 2x filtering process. And the next step is synthesis process. For 0.01 molarity, mixing 0.2 gram of zinc nitrate with 70 milliliter of extract, and this mixture will be stirred for 1 hour, and then place it in the water bath at 60 degrees Celsius for 1 hour. And the final step is ferritate of pH with adding vinegar and natrium hydroxide. And after the synthesis is completed, the sample will be characterized by UVVs and photoluminescence to see value of the absorption and luminescence of the sample. Okay, that's all from me. If you're interested about my research, please contact me and let's do some discussion. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Siti. Next, we're going to move on to Lira Senja Alfitra.
Yes, sir. Could you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so if you are a coffee person, your day probably won't start before you brew a morning cup of coffee or grab one at your favorite coffee shop. But did you know that behind the perfect coffee, there is a science behind it? My name is Lira Senja, and today I will discuss parameters in coffee extraction and how science can make the perfect caffeine. So, what is coffee? Coffee is a drink made from the roasted and ground seeds of a tropical plant. Coffee is a drink that is quite popular among the people. Indonesia itself is the fourth largest producing country in the world. Coffee is very easy to find in Indonesia, ranging from low quality to the best quality. Luwak coffee, which is known as the most expensive coffee in the world, is also produced in Indonesia. Although there are many varieties of coffee around the world, two of the most common and well-known types of coffee are Arabica and Robusta. Coffee is produced from the processing and extraction of coffee beans, Broadly speaking, coffee bean processing consists of three stages, namely the roasting process, the grinding process, and the brewing process. Extraction occurs every time you brew coffee. When coffee meets water, it picks up the aroma, taste, and other substances in a cup of coffee. However, in brewing coffee, there are several parameters that we must control so that we will get the ideal extraction. Processing parameters and variables in the coffee extraction process contribute greatly to the flavor, quality, and consumer acceptance of the coffee extraction process. To achieve the ideal extraction when we brew coffee, we should at least pay attention to the following three things: grind size, time of extraction, and water temperature. The aim of this research is to study the effect of grind size, temperature, and time extraction of Arabica coffee. So one of the compounds in coffee is caffeine. Caffeine is a compound of the xanthine alkaloid group and is believed by most people to fight drowsiness. In general, coffee is a nerve stimulant for the human body. On this basis, why coffee drinks or tea will relieve drowsiness and fight fatigue. The body will feel fitter after drinking a cup of coffee. According to the European Food Information Council and the International Coffee Organization, the recommended amount of caffeine and within the safe limit of consumption is as much as 300 milligrams per day. This is equivalent to 5 cups of tea or instant coffee, 3 cups of Robusta, and 2 glasses of Arabica. Although in some studies it is said that caffeine consumption of 1,000 milligrams a day is still safe, consumption should be limited to only 300 milligrams per day, considering the level of caffeine acceptance in body varies in each individual. So coffee extraction is carried out by different methods to produce the brew. This process involves water absorption by the coffee grinds, mass transfer of soluble compounds from the ground coffee into the hot water, and then separation of the resulting extract from coffee solids. And then during the coffee brewing, volatile and non-volatile flavor compounds are removed from the ground with hot water and distributed between water, oil, and solid phases. As shown in this figure, multiple variables affect the coffee extraction process. So factors that affect the brewing process are the extraction time, temperature of water, and particle size. The extraction time will affect the content of dissolved materials, color, and aroma. The longer the brewing, the chance of contact between brewing water and coffee is longer, so that the extraction process becomes more perfect. Likewise with the temperature water. The higher the water temperature, the ability of water to extract the chemical content contained in coffee will be higher. Studies have shown that using increasing gradient temperature profiles between 88 to 93 degrees Celsius resulted in increased caffeine, a few acidic compounds, and chlorogenic acid extraction. The particle size of the roast and coffee grounds determines the extraction rates of several chemical compounds, which define the final flavor of the coffee beverage. Grinding increases the extraction surface area, thereby increase the interface between water and coffee. The method used in this research is a laboratory test with UVB spectrophotometry method. And the working principle of this method is that the amount of light absorbed by the solution is proportional to the concentration of contaminants in the solution. Spectrophotometric methods are expected to be used for determination of caffeine levels in coffee because it is relatively fast, simple, and relatively inexpensive. There are three things to do. First, preparation of caffeine raw solution. Caffeine powder is weighed as much as 0.1 grams and then dissolved with ethanol in a measuring flask, then diluted. And then preparation of working solution. Caffeine working solution was prepared by diluting standard solution of 100 ppm. And then to determine determination of caffeine levels, then based off temperature and extraction time, First, 4 grams of the sample was weighed, then added 30 milliliters of distilled water at a temperature of 50 degrees Celsius, with variation in extraction time, 0 hour, 1 hour, 1.5 hours, 2 hours, and 4 hours. Then filtered and pipetted 10 milliliters of the filtrate. Next, add 4 milliliters of 0.01 molar hydrochloric acid and 1 milliliter of lead to acetate trihydrate, and then put 25 milliliters of the filtrate in a 50 milliliter volumetric flask. Add 0.3 milliliter of 3 molar sulfuric acid, and then dilute it. Then the absorbance of the filtrate was measured at maximum wavelength of 275 nanometer. The same test was carried out at 70 degrees and 100 degrees Celsius. I think that's all from me. Thank you for your time and have a good day.
Okay, thank you, Lira. And with that, we're moving on to the ninth presenter. I would like to call Maria Cindrawati.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. Oh, wait. Sorry. Okay. Okay, good morning, sir, and all my friends in this class. My name is Maria Cindrawati. Today, I'd like to talk about analysis of clay mineral characteristic in hydrothermally altered rocks in the Mount Lawu geothermal system using petrographic and X-ray diffraction method. So our country, Indonesia, is one of the country that is part of the Ring of Fire trajectory, which makes Indonesia a source of geothermal energy. Geothermal energy is heat energy stored in subsurface rock and fluid surface. It is as a natural mineral source found in volcanic pathways. And then how to indicate the existence of geothermal system in the area. So the difference of geothermal heat can be expressed from the manifestation that occur on the surface. This is the surface manifestation, unlike fumaroles, hot spraying, boiling spraying, geyser, and zone of acid alteration. And then the geothermal potential of an area can be determined through change in the texture, mineralogy, and the chemical composition of the rocks caused by hydrothermal fluid activity. And then this is the purpose of my research, is determine the characteristic and presence of clay mineral in LW1 and LW2 wells based on petrographic and XRD method and their relationship to the formation of the Mount Lawu geothermal system. So this is the research location in this study. This is LW1 and this is LW2. It's located to the south of Mount Lawu, precisely in the depression zone between Mount Lawu and Mount Jabulorongan. And then why did I choose the Mount Lawu area? So in the environment of Mount Lawu itself, there are some geothermal manifestation. There are such as like fumaroles, hot spring, and alteration rocks, which clearly indicate the existence of geothermal system in this area. So where do this manifestation come from? The geothermal system at Mount Lawu, it's thought to be related to the volcanic activity of the mountain, which still stores residual heat from the magma chamber. This residual heat the field which then rises to the surface, and then the interaction between the field and the surrounding rock will result the appearance of altered rock. So the sign that the rock is product of hydrothermal alteration is to know the characteristic of the alteration mineral, especially the percent of clay mineral. So this is the characteristic of clay minerals. So basically clay mineral is secondary mineral that is formed to the influence of the climate, vegetation, fauna, and human activities. And then lithography, landscape, time, vitreous alteration in the parent rocks, and then the minerals contained in that rock. So how do we know that the characteristic of us mineral? So this is the method that I use. There is two methods. First is phenography. So this analysis are used as microscope, whose name is polarization microscope. So the purpose of this analysis is to determine the type of secondary rocks and mineral forms and the intensity of their chains. And then to determine the presence of clay mineral that cannot be the time determined with this method, with this petrography method, it can be done through the SRD method. So this is the SRD or X-ray diffraction. So X-ray diffraction is a method that can be used to identify group and subgroup of clay mineral based on their reflection. And this is this method is very sustainable. So stable for identifying clay mineral because it's used an X-ray spectrum with a wavelength about 20 meter until 2 nanometer. So this is the SRD basic law, refers to the Bragg law formula. And then this is my flowchart of this research. So starting with sample preparation and then entering two method, which is petrography and XRD method, and then the XRD result of on a mineral is will produce certain diffraction peaks where each crystal has a different atomic structure characteristic from the other. From this, we can analyze the relationship between the diffraction angle, and then and then the thickness of the unit cell or the distance between the crystal plane and the intensity of the light being diffracted. After that, we can find out the type of clay mineral containing it. Okay, so this is bring me to the end of my presentation. Thank you all for your attention and for listening to my presentation, and good morning all. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, Maria. With that, we're going to move to the 10th presentation. I would like to call Miranda Sitompul.
Yes, sir. Can you see my screen, sir? Good morning, everybody. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Miranda Sitompul, and I'm here to present my research. This presentation is about digital signal processing based on radio wave spectrum measurement at Timau National Observatory Area, Kupang. The first is introduction. Mystery in space-time is required by law number 21 of 2013. It's not limited to research effort of space weather, space environment, and astrophysics, but are required to perform space research like satellite and national observatory. Based on the regulation of BRIN RI number 5 of 2021, LAPAN has the task of carrying out technical tests of research, development, study, and application, as well as innovation and innovation. Why we do the research? It's because LAPAN want to build the first radio telescope in Indonesia at Timau. Then an analysis of the electromagnetic signal in the area is needed. We will see it by graph and characteristic of the signal or electromagnetic wave. The second is theory. The first is antenna horn. Antenna horn is the antenna that we use is in measuring the signal around the Timau National Observatory. This antenna is a microwave antenna and is low cost to perform efficient measurement. This horn antenna can cover the frequency range for 168 to 18 gigahertz. Antenna is a device usually made of metal to transmit or receive radio waves. Antenna is a transitional structure between the free space and the waveguide. The second is Fourier transform. Fourier transform is a mathematical operation calculation technique used to transform from analog signal into frequency-based digital signal. Transform the signal from time domain into frequency domain. Consists of discrete Fourier transform and fast Fourier transform. Discrete Fourier transform is a form of Fourier transform used in additional operation. Discrete Fourier transform has the order n square. It takes a long time to complete the calculation if the data is very much. So to optimize the computational process, DFT can be modified with an algorithm that we often know as fast Fourier transform atau FFT. FFT is an algorithm that calculates DFT quickly and efficiently. FFT reduces the order of DFT n square become n log 2 square, n log 2 n. This is the example of signal in time domain. And this is the example of signal in frequency domain after we transform with Fourier transform. Okay, the third is MATLAB. In this research, I use MATLAB to process the data. MATLAB is our matrix laboratory, is a program for numerical analysis and computation. MATLAB is software for technical computing, visualization, and program needs such as mathematical computation, data analysis, algorithm development, simulation, and modeling and graph calculation. Okay, that is methodology. In this research, I used two tools, namely antenna horn to measure the signal at Timau, and then I process the data with MATLAB software. This is the location of measurement at Timau National Observatory. We can see in this table, there's code pin. It means the point of measurement. For example, R1N, it means radius 1 kilometer north direction. R2N, it means radius 1 kilometer north direction. In this table, there are 10 data, but in my research, I just processing 3 data. Okay, the process is the first. The signal is measure use antenna horn. And then frequency signal measurement are carried out in four different measurement direction, namely EN or north direction east line, NN north direction north line, SN north direction south line, and WN AWN north direction west line, and at a radius of 1 kilometer, 2 kilometers, and 3 kilometers. An example of naming data is EN1R. It's mean north direction east line, radius 1 kilometer. Other that, the frequency captured by this antenna is frequency of 168 megahertz to 18 gigahertz, which is then which is then divided into seven part, namely F1 until F7. After measuring, the data obtained is data in the time domain, so it must be converted to a frequency domain with Fourier transform in MATLAB, and the data of the frequency and spectral amplitude value are separate for each measurement direction. Then the data from F1 until F7 are combined according to direction of measurement. Process the data with statistical calculation, for example, percentile or mean, because repeated measurement are carrying out at several points. So we get, finally, we get four tables for each radius, namely 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, and 3 kilometer. And we get a total table is 16. Each table is then plot into a graph, and it's the data if the data have outlier data, we repair or adjust the data. After the data has been adjusted and the resulting graph is unexpected, then we perform statistical calculation and statistical analysis.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but you have 1 minute to conclude.
Okay, that's all my presentation today. Thank you so much for your attention. I hope that you can find something useful from my presentation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the last presenter of today is Ella Fatasha. We have Ella in the classroom. We have Ella in the classroom, so let me check the participants. Oh well, since there are no Ella, I guess we're just going to conclude our session today. We already see 10 students delivering their progress on the scientific topic that they choose to present in scientific communication class. So in Monday, we will continue our 8 minutes presentation. There will be 5 students that are going to talk about their selected topic. And in next Thursday, we're going to conclude with the rest of the students that haven't got a chance to present. Okay, so thank you all for attending the class. Remember to fill in the assessment sheet that you need to fill in order for the presenter got their marks on their presentation. And in the following week, which is next week, after we're done with all presentation, all of the assessment sheet and also the copy of your presentation slide need to be uploaded to the Google Drive folder as a proof that you already done with the assignment. Okay, so With this, I would like to conclude our meeting today. Thank you all for your attention. We're going to meet each other again on Monday for the continuation of the 8-minute presentation. Let me stop the recording.